have a rendezvous at the hairdresser. I said, you let me the car, and I give you a car to go to your hairdresser. And you let me your car. She said, oh, I said, oh, it's perfect. While I'm getting I say yes, I do a collar. I do his collar. he's funny, hein, that garagist is a.
Hello, hello, what's going on? This is Alan Silva broadcasting here from our studios here in Lamont, and what we're going to do is be playing some of our videos from our YouTube concept, which is a free jazz art concept at YouTube here at Google Hangout or Hangout. My name is Alan Silver, and I was the creator of the videos on my channel, Alan Silver, for the Institute for Higher Audiovisual Emotions and Consciousness, which is another phrase for that, on the YouTube channel. We have about 200, 300, well, 405 videos. We've been on YouTube since its conception, actually, around 2006. Our main thing is presenting jazz and improvised music across the board with our different activities that I do, which is we have a broadcast, two broadcasting stations on live365.com. Been there since the same time we created our YouTube site. And the continuation of this this use of this technology, the internet, in creating visual as well as musical concepts. For me, the main thing about the internet was the ability for artists, internet artists. That's the difference between if you consider yourself an artist, a published artist, or unpublished artist. Those are two different concepts that technology is different than printing, for instance. So a lot of people saw the internet as publishing. Because you can make a web page and you can publish your works on the internet in a digital format. That even goes back from the beginning. So people could see your work, see your words that you could write, web pages. Fundamentally, musicians didn't have the audio stream or be able to upload audio files in the very beginning of the internet. In the sense that you would upload to I don't know the technological aspects of it, but I assume that in the 90s, artists, musical artists, people wanted to publish their music in a digital format. Most of us thought putting on a record, most of us thought publishing music was putting it on a piece of paper. But musicians who improvise don't deal with paper. They kind of deal with their instrument, and they deal with their sound, and they're actually don't document their creations. But consequently, they might miss out on some stuff. But myself, I was very much conscious of recording aspects of improvised music, even as early as 1970. 65, 61, 62, when we were involved in taping a band using a ball and sack tape recorder. Now, getting back to the internet and the development of YouTube and my relationship with YouTube based on the fact that I was interested in putting up short videos. I had a video camera since quite a while, and it collected a lot of different kinds of events. So before the pro internet, or YouTube, I mean, most of us were thinking just like to put those tapes on VHS tape, or not even thinking that we were marketable, mostly for home consumption. The whole video movement, in fact, was the technology of these cameras. I was taking serious as a serious art, video art, television, the idea that you can record images onto a videotape, and then you'd have an original tape, and you could duplicate that tape, and then you could put that on the TV. I mean, lucky that one person could see that TV, but actually transmit images across the entire system, it needed a broadcast system. And television stations were in control of this signal going to their televisions. People bought. Most video artists kind of consequently didn't have any broadcast or transmission systems, any connection with any TVs, especially in the United States or Europe. They couldn't broadcast their tapes, actually. Those broadcasting systems were controlled by either government or private corporations who had access to that kind of system. But videotape being transmitted on a playback system was a main interest for me at the beginning. Well, okay, got a video recorder and a TV. So in fact, the TV became one broadcasting system. That was 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s. That's 40 years of underground videos, basically. I'm sure there's a lot of artists out there between the 70s and the 80s producing video. Camera. Even myself. I was more interested in audio aspects of it. So, in a sense, the internet came along. At first, in the 90s, that was like, you know, okay, mostly for people who would actually make a web page, I guess. Speeding up this whole process to see where we are now, Free Jazz Art, and present day here. 1:30 here in Le Mans, Paris, with Alan Silva on Free Jazz Art. And where we are today in the technology with Google Plus providing people with a platform for streaming a hangout. I mean, which is a way of me as a video artist and channel person to be able to organize some events from a channel point of view. We have 403 videos on our channel on YouTube. Not a concept of that was in the early parts of my residence here at YouTube was creating music videos, visuals. That's using software, visualization software, which is like different kinds of companies that create software. And so you have many different examples of that kind of work on my channel. In the early beginnings, we used, like, you can go back to Cecil Taylor, we have short. In the early beginnings, we had problems because music was owned, copyrighted by composers. And since the composers were being put on YouTube without being paid, without any royalties being paid to their music, it was very hard for us as visual artists to use their music without them getting paid. And we were not even paid at all, actually. We were making content. So at the present moment, we're now in, I guess, 2006 to 2012, and coming out of Christmas time and around this particular period, you know, holiday seasons. So I thought, you know, I'd do a holiday show. usually on YouTube, we put up Peter Catherine, who has a channel to YouTube, and who is part of Hangout, her own Hangout. Catherine, so she's on Facebook too. But this Hangout concept was the first time I actually said, okay, I'm going to do a Hangout here on YouTube. The only I'm working on upstream or live stream or just those were all streaming, early streaming people who did live streams. And the difference between live streams and video was that you had to prepare the videos and then you have to upload them to YouTube. live stream and upstream and Judson allowed us to stream and record the videos, and they would be available for people to see these videos kind of immediately after the program streamed. They upstream and live stream, Judson were kind of pioneers in this kind of streaming concept. Judson, you know, like people just sitting in front of their webcam and just trying to get people to come into their chat room. Content providers, people from television shows, stuff like that, movies that I was interested in putting up my music videos of my record collection, which was coming from live365.com, which was a platform for record collectors or DJs or people who wanted to break into the DJ business, or even people at the early parts just interested in putting their record collection up. And Live365, I discovered them in 2006, I guess, as a platform. And that became interesting because you could stream live music directly from the computer, or you could upload something to their server. I prefer to, I had preferred to use the live software development. Because basically if you're online on the internet and your use of the internet in the old days was like a dial-up, like because we all, most of the internet was connected to your telephone. And so time you spent on the internet was like pay for the time.
Okay.
So, yeah, I mean, no one's there, but I mean, no talking to myself, you know.
Okay. No,
I'm we're having a hangout. We're having a hangout here, you know. Here, nobody's there. See?
Yeah.
Talking to myself. My entire life is on the internet. It's based on talking to myself. You know what I mean? I don't know why people think that, you know, maybe that's a reflection of my, people say, why would you do that? I said, well, simply because I always thought that it would be great to have my own television.
To look at this.
Exactly. Even that was when in the early days of TV, I thought, wow, I can do better than that. I mean, so I take it upon myself to think that the kind of music that I choose to do on my show is my choice. And I like that about 365.com in terms of music. So it gave a lot of people the chance to develop their own radio concept because of the internet. And that's why I thought at the beginning of the internet was like really a bunch of really great technological people opening up a possibility of how to use a computer, number one. I mean, they figured out that connecting computers were their main technological aspects of it. But the computer outside of the internet was an interesting tool. Making sounds, making visuals, you know, all the connection between video and the computer, the evolution of that, coming from tape to night now, it's all files. So the computer was in video and sound were already making impacts on the art production and on photographic. And storage. So if you was an artist, or you a photographer, photographing stuff, and you didn't have to print it, you could put it up on your computer. That saved a lot of immediate. That saved a lot of time going to get it developed. Then the whole concept between a computer and printing is another big thing. The idea that you print your own stuff at home. I mean, original copies of transcriptions or your poetry or your thoughts or anything. And then you can make a book. One copy, two copies, doesn't make any difference. The fundamental thing is, people seem to understand that in artistic sense, the idea that you can publish a piece of artwork is absolutely different than being in a gallery or publishing an artwork. That's a photograph, copy of a photograph, and transmitting it across to somebody. So in a sense, this is a whole new era for what we call, at one point, the avant-garde was always an underground movement. It was only been documented by a few, two or three people in the mainstream. The underground was always being documented by itself, or nobody was interested. Historians, musicologists, academic people don't consider the urban environment. They can study. That's why people go to universities, simply because they get a university gig and they stay in the university. They don't actually go out and do any research or anything. So, basically, that's my intention, is that there are artists all over the world, took hands of artists, and the internet provides them with a platform for publishing their works. And at the beginning, I mean, people were thinking, oh yeah, you know, I mean, it's like, okay, but those persons who buy a computer and then go and get live and pay whatever money you pay to be online or be access to the internet from a computer. Now with mobile phones and whatever you wanna, how are you gonna get there? But the fact is that most of the young people between the ages of, they were mostly attached to this computer generation. But you take people from 30 to 65, computer skills are really, really bad. Doesn't have to have too much computer skills, but it depends on what how they've been controlled. You know, like say in France, for instance, I mean, French people have been basically controlled simply because they had one people broadcasting them information. That was the ORTF, or television and radio were controlled. It wasn't a matter of control, it was just a matter that they had the broadcasting system. And how information was transmitted across the country, or how people got information, primarily through these types of systems. Any underground movement having any of the information or events that they might have, they would never surface in the mainstream media, basically. Mainstream media does not cover these type of events. And there may be hundreds of art events in any given time or place. And that's sometimes people get disturbed with you know, culture as culture defined by what? No, leave it the way it is, Catherine. No, you're still talking. Because I drink coffee all day, Catherine. What are you talking about? Thank you. So you have the whole idea that that the internet. Will you let me speak, Catherine?
What?
I'm talking.
Yeah, I'm going now.
Okay. So go. Bring my train of thought. I'm talking, Catherine.
Yeah, okay. That's for your paper, but I don't play with my book card for the paper. Okay.
So, as I was rudely interrupted by my wife as trying to speak, I have one person here, anyway. And she's going off to shop at the present moment.
I'm sorry, I didn't know that you're
So, I was getting my train of thought, like getting my rhythm, getting my rhythm here on Free-Jazz Art with alansilva, and the impact that the hangouts could have on the art market. I mean, on the free-jazz market, or the idea that an artist can interact with other people. And that becomes a big issue, I guess, for a lot of people who don't think that artists deserve a transmission system other than the one that's the mainstream. A lot of artists think, okay, I'm going to be in a museum, or that's mainstream. and they don't feel that they have any worth outside of the mainstream. I kind of disagree with that fundamentally, because I believe that there's a lot of artists out there. There's a lot of expression. There's lots of information, and none of this information we are aware of. So our culture, the culture that is like just little groups of people, maybe. some people don't join these groups, or some people participate in these groups as anonymous or as anonymous people. We don't know how many records. I'm a musician or an artist. We don't really know how many people, when they look at a video of mine, they don't make any comment about it. They don't say anything. Even if it's a small amount of people, 23, 24, 25 people. So any communications between the artists and public on this kind of platform is essential for it to be, for it to have any value to the artist. A lot of people say, "Oh, yeah, well, I don't think that these kind of systems are valuable as opposed to the mainstream." Well, mainstream's got their mainstream, basically. You know, when on the internet was created, it was created by a bunch of tech people. A bunch of guys who are technologically smart enough to make that possible. Of course, Wall Street had a lot to do with it too, I guess. A lot of investment there too. And what is internet culture? Other than, you know, e-commerce and all that. There's a lot of different aspects of transmission giving me the right here to, you know, Google and YouTube giving me the right here to have an ongoing conversation with myself. And it's being recorded, I mean. And to give up storage space, at first, I mean, I would think that I would have to, as an artist, I would store that myself, and I own that material myself. Was a record I bought, not something I stole. It was a record I bought, and I made some visualizations of some of those early records, which I had a keen interest in the evolution of how people visualize music. We use the word visualization as opposed to saying it's art music, or music videos, or things like that. Even though the medium is, of course, video, but it's the image of the music that I was interested in, even early back in. Early period of my life was in the 60s when I was involved with abstract expressionism and the early beginnings of jazz music or what was improvisation, you know, and what was improvisation in abstract expression? Improvisation in general means some kind of train of thought. We all thought artists and things. Now, let me just speak. A train of thought, or what we call just a train of interactions. This is a monologue because I'm talking to myself, basically. And I'm just letting my mind create. I have a subject that I'm speaking about. So in music is the same. I mean, to a certain degree, that improvisers have a subject. They had to have a subject because they wouldn't be able to talk. They wouldn't be able to play without a subject. A lot of people say, well, okay, it's like, you know, it's like randomization or something. Yes, but human beings are capable of creating what was called a narrative. whatever it might be. We have, in our life, we have a narrative. Our life is based on being a narrative, fundamentally, going outside, inside, or all the actions that we do on a day-to-day level. Some of that, you know, for each person, it's real. It's a real reality. Whether or not it's art, well, that's to the person themselves. As far as what is called, generally, people, the human being is capable of self-expression. It seems that the Homo sapiens have developed that on a massive level, especially when they learned how to speak. Some of them learned how to speak, but I think that Compton was saying that, you know, the development of grammar and audio grammar and able to speak to each other. I guess that created a whole lot of things, a lot of subjects that we'll never know, that the human beings have talked about. Go back 100 years, what do people talk about? We don't have any record of that. We have fundamentally no record of anything past 10 years ago, what the common people speak. We know what some leaders are talking about, what some journalists decide to write about a particular situation. But generally speaking, we don't really know what people are saying. The only way we could know that possibly is we can look at some home movies. And even home movies are like not really, or photographs or something like that. So us, but artists, self-expression is very broad, a broad concept. So in terms of people being used self-expression in the culture, that's where the internet came, you know, and like people doing social networking and communicating themselves like I'm doing here. Google decided to have a hangout. What is a hangout going to be? Well, it's just like some people sitting around, supposedly talking to each other or listening to each other. So you have to have some kind of something to say. Anyways, after I said that, what is the subject that we're supposed to be dealing with today on the hangout? Well, since since free jazz art concept. Well, as I said before, that I can give you some idea of that, you know. And we're gonna now shift a little bit to some of the videos that are on my channel. And I'm gonna come back. We'll look at some of these videos that we have done over the period of time. The thing is there are different kinds of software that have been around. I guess you could go to Google and put in Google search visualized software, you know. On this particular video, I have a Macintosh computer. And in Macintosh computer, on iTunes, you have a visualizers. When you buy a Mac computer, there's a company that provides them with a software, a visualizer software. And that is a company that works with Mac. And then they have their own visualizers that you can download into their program, and if you have a PC, then you have a whole lot of other Microsoft developed visualizers too. Media players. So that was, you know, the idea of these guys who created these first software ideas. Myself, I was, at the beginning, I was more interested in film. how music and film, for instance, there's two different aspects of that, you know, recording a band playing, or documenting a band playing with one single angle camera, which is a concept, with one camera taking a band, or letting the camera simply don't move at all, no intervention. Single camera work for that kind of work is you can see a lot of stuff done on that area. The second one is, as I said, with this software, was the ability to record these actions. And I had the iMac computer, the recent one, has a video caption program, which you capture what's on the screen of your what's happening on the screen. And that was interesting. I could then record what was happening with this software on the screen. And that was on the first IMAX, I think in 2006, 2007. Or I could put stuff that was happening right into the computer itself. But it was interesting how these software called GeForce software. I downloaded it and made it available. So we're going to move on to that section. Well, these concepts here that you see broadcasting here is basically Yeah, well, I'm off the air there for a minute. I don't know what happened. But we're getting back to that last program we was in at freejazzART video. One of the programs we, one of the videos that we have put up on live, I mean, on YouTube. That was an interesting project in the sense that it was using a program, CamTwist. CamTwist is a program in which it, you can broadcast, if you can get that there right here on, they have their own channel here on YouTube called CamTwist. It is a broadcast software. And I was using that software to create my program on that you just saw there with jazz, free jazz art programs. And we were using that differently throughout. We had a program that you saw with the inside the some slideshow, working with some of my slides, and a visualization software called Cubism, which is a kind of deals with the frequencies of the song itself and how it interprets the audio frequency and it moves in space and time. And the actual page, you could actually broadcast a page of the actual station with the album covers. And on there, you could put, you know, you could put a webcam and where you have the picture of yourself and you're broadcasting. And you can turn and go to a next, what do you call, buttons and create another picture, which I had the visualizations on. And you can put text on top of the video. So it's a very interesting program. It's called CamTwist. CamTwist was the key, was one of the keys for us here in terms of broadcasting and live broadcasting and building videos for streaming stations such as Upstream and at that time we had Upstream, Livestream, Judson, and so forth. I mean, YouTube didn't have, at that time, any kind of streaming concept, such as the Hangout at that point. And so I was using that to create programs and recording them on each one of these platforms. And that was like creating what I call playlists of those particular stations. On those live365.com jazz stations. There are 353 jazz stations. So that's how that would kind of work. And that was a 2-hour recording show I did and recorded on Upstream, live stream and so forth. And then I was able to put that on my YouTube site. When YouTube decided that it could take up 2 hours, you know, time, that would take a long time to upload quality videos to YouTube. I mean, you know, a 2-hour show would take quite a while. but streaming a 2-hour show is a little less tedious for storage aspects. But what is interesting about streaming is that you know, the difference between making a video on YouTube and streaming the same program is that you're live and it's a live event and it's recorded. Before YouTube made, basically, they were making videos available for no less than 15 minutes. That was the maximum. And so some music was over 15 minutes. So I began in the same period at the same chamber. YouTube and Upstream, Judson, Livestream, all kind of like appeared at kind of the same time, but YouTube became the most big platform for video, but not for streaming. And then now, after 6 years, I guess we're on 2012, I mean, most of these guys have transformed themselves. YouTube, obviously, now. Google. Most of these were startups. It's still startups, actually, but Google popped in and became the dominant on YouTube. I mean, YouTube still is the dominant user-generated site. I mean, if you look at it from the point of view of how many people look at videos, you would say that YouTube is still the key place where everybody goes. And from the music point of view, of course, we have streaming radio, which is live365.com, and I mean, that's a worldwide situation, and you have developed that. But my idea was taking these radio stations and actually building a visualization kind of information stream. And you can see there that is what you would see if you were on the web page of that jazz program that we just broadcast. And that would be the album cover and the record itself and the sound and my webcam picture, and then this visualization concept. So that was what that video was about. It's 2 hours and 35 minute show that I put on Upstream and then recorded it on Upstream. And then Upstream related to YouTube so that when they allowed more than user-generated visuals, which in the early parts of YouTube's history, there were many guys that had put up visualization and some people using music, I mean music from their record collection, and putting up audio stuff. The audio So I consider my work here at YouTube to be about visualization of music and how we can use slideshows or how we can use some software, that software generated, especially if you're in a Mac, which I was in the Mac zone, which was not too many software makers who actually did it. I mean, in terms of on Mac. I mean, except for Mac people. I mean, on PCs, there are a lot of software developers developed visualization software. Since I stayed within the Mac platform, I didn't change the PC scale, only kind of limited. Another program there was Mr. Black. It's another program, another software developer who developed a quantum software, which was a way of using different kinds of quantum development programs. And they developed a software called Quantum. And you could put a photograph into the space and put a video on top of it, play a video on top of that over the background. That's what you saw in that video, basically. And I could change with that was like a button. You know, a button, he called it a cam twist button. And that was constructed. You can put things into the button. You can put a movie into the button. You can put a web page into the button. And you can have different transparents into the space. You can build things on top of things. Very interesting software to build a. You can put text into it. You can have moving text, as you saw it in the bottom there with FreeJazz across the bottom. You can have a fixed text that you had there with Jazz, or Jazz Note, which is a text. And so you can build an interesting stream from that. Idea of combining a Live 365 radio concept, which is the web page, which is gives you the information about what tunes they are and the record cover in the space. And it's a whole web page, of course, but I only took the information necessary. So it was a way of my early development. I think that video was made about something like 1 year ago, 2 years ago. We go more earlier to my earlier works, the beginning of my career, which we explore. Those were dealing with videos from my high eight period, transferring these into digital material. The idea that jazz or improvised music, and then the idea that YouTube was thinking about user-generated, and this major problem, obviously, was with how to get music up on YouTube without paying anybody any money. I mean, since they didn't want to deal with the record label, I guess, in the beginning. They were, conceptually speaking, not like Live 365, which actually dealt with audio records, and they actually paid royalties to Sound Exchange. Composers. YouTube. So a lot of guys started channels with records or songs and putting them on YouTube. And of course, that would violate user-generated music. We had this whole big issue on YouTube whether or not we could put up music. We had a video with some music in it. We couldn't pay the composers. So for me as a professional, I became on YouTube. That's why I moved my visual operation to upstream, which was a stream, and since the stream was just streaming, wasn't any video made, the people listening to it as or seeing the object, you know, it's kind of a form of promotion, actually. For the moment, let's see. And so we could develop these concepts of streaming music and visuals. That's primarily what I was interested in. It was like creating music for YouTube. It was creating videos, specific videos for YouTube. But streaming, I was interested in streaming because it's more easier. It's, it doesn't take any time to upload. You know, you're just putting it on the net. I mean, and depending on your internet connection, because if you're streaming, you could have a lot of problems with your internet connection because you have to have kind of a high speed internet connection to actually do it. Now, so that's music on 365, but people actually heard the music without any, not too much of a break. But that would only depend on people's, a lot of dependent on people's connection at the time, you know, broadband, dial up. We're at this point, I guess, globally speaking, broadband and DSL here, where people still, I assume, can see a live program, not in like ideal, it depends. If you have an old computer or a new one, it's better. iPad now, Surface. Mobile phones. So streaming, you know, or what I think here on Hangout is, as opposed to upstream and Saturn, people who pioneered in streaming programs. But these, if I look at upstream, still we don't have quite a number of people actually watching these streams. Even this one up today, nobody here actually looking at my stream. But I guess that's the nature of the system. So much information and so many different people doing so many things, they may not be thinking that that would be interesting to them or that I'm not interested. But that's basically the hit and miss area of anyway communications. It's like how many people look at a post, or why some people look at more than that. Or I don't really concern myself. Fundamentally, I use this technology because I have it, and I use it. I'm using it today because I'm part of a channel in upstream. I mean, YouTube, and Google Plus provides this, so I'm making a program. So we're gonna go look at another video. How's everybody doing? I just made a little mistake. I was wondering if you could give me the concept here. I was just wondering, as can you look at my videos while still my camera is still active? And I was on my YouTube site playing some videos, and it doesn't look like people see the videos. They see my cam. And that was interesting. I thought that people were looking at the videos that I was putting up. So it'd be interesting to know how that actually works. How does people look at the videos that from my YouTube? On the caption aspect, or do I put up videos from my? I was just looking at the live stream, and the live stream didn't have the videos from there. Anyway, this is Alan Silver here at Free Jazz Art Concept, and just put up a link to my. My Facebook account. So we haven't had any viewers here passing by while I'm here. But I was wondering, anybody understand that? How that people actually do they enter the room or what? I mean, so this stream is basically my stream. What have I had on my camera? So I was wondering, I wanted to broadcast a video. What would that be? Still working with this concept here. I'm gonna try something.